But when we first met, it was not a luncheon, but it was the writer's salon, a class thing, where you were teaching.
At Hollywood High,
and that's what I was referring to when I first called her. And, you know, it's obvious that that was a long time ago.
It was that right was in the beginning
when
of the show.
Your show first, like, hit and got exciting and thrilling. And now look,
it's bizarre. It's definitely bizarre for me.
Didn't Winnie sort of reach out to you, if I'm remembering it correctly, because you were embarking on running your own show and she just wanted to sort of...
Yeah, she sort of said, I want to take you to lunch. Or it was breakfast, actually, I think it was.
We had breakfast,
breakfast. And
what'd you have for breakfast?
Oh, God. Some eggs of some kind. But what was really great about it for me was as a movie writer, I didn't know any other writers. I literally didn't know any other writers except for the writers who were working on our show. And also, I was petrified at the time. The show had become, I really thought we were going to make the pilot and then never do anything else. That I thought we were going to make the first 13 and never do anything else. And the show got really popular in a way that was a little bit scary for me at the time. I just didn't know what to do with it. And
did you feel almost like, wow, how did I do that? Like,
yeah, I felt like I had accidentally done something that turned out to be a big deal. And that was bizarre for me. And when you took me to lunch, what was great was there was sort of somebody across the table who you looked at me and you basically said, so this is how you're feeling. This is what you're thinking. This is what's going through your head. And I felt such a relief because I felt like somebody else actually gets this because it's a bizarrely lonely feeling.
Well, it's, you know, that's interesting. It's a very lonely, that's a lonely place to be, is running your show.
Yeah.
Because you're not one of the writers.
Everybody works for you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And you also, in order to do your job, you have to be locked away in your room a lot writing
right.
and thinking. And that's intensive.
It's very intensive. And I was spending all my time with these people who I'd created in my head who didn't exist for real. And that was just very strange to feel like those were now my friends and I wasn't spending time with my friends.
And that's true in a way.
It was really true. It was very strange. And I had a baby at the time. And so any free time I had, I was spending with my child and feeling like the only grown-ups I knew were these characters, which was very strange.
I have like about 40 questions already from what you just said. But
me too.
Will you just talk very briefly about you were writing features, introducing Dorothy Dandridge. You were writing movies and Princess Bride,
Princess Diaries two.
But what led you to go from that to TV? And can you talk also about a little bit of that culture shock from, you know, single solitary sport to team sport?
I had been writing movies and I had been having fun with it. I mean, I really had been having fun with it and was very excited about it and like did everything from Dorothy Dandridge to like 10 rewrites on Frida Kahlo to Crossroads to, I mean, I'd done a bunch of very, very different things and really sort of felt like it was fine, but it's never... In film, it's never yours as a writer. It's always the director's vision, for better or for worse. And I have had some really wonderful experiences. My experiences on Princess Diaries 2 was great. I mean, that was a lovely, lovely experience. My experience on Dorothy Dandridge was great. Martha Coolidge was amazing.
I love that movie.
And incredibly collaborative. Like, it was a wonderful experience. But it's still, at the end of the day, it's the director's vision. And was sort of looking for a way to feel... a little bit more like it was mine, I guess.
But you didn't think about directing or it just sort of...
I did. I mean, I did for a short time. I had like a 3-picture deal to direct at Miramax and then had a run-in with Harvey Weinstein. But
whoa!
Other story. Whoa. Another story. But it wasn't really what I had been... It didn't feel right. It wasn't what I had been looking for. And then I had a daughter... And I was at home suddenly. Like, I had gone from being sort of this single woman who was out with her friends at night to you don't get to go anywhere when you have a kid because that's, like, the law or something. it's illegal to leave a child home alone. So
I'd heard that somewhere.
You are shitting me. Thank God I didn't have any.
Easy, yeah. So,
you know, with cats, you can just, like, leave dry food out and they go in the box. It's fantastic.
Babies, not so much. Yeah. So... I was at home suddenly a lot and watching more television than I had ever watched before. and discovering stuff that I hadn't seen. A lot of stuff on DVD, because there was a lot of weird reality shows on and people singing and stuff. But really discovering stuff I hadn't seen, like I discovered Buffy, and I discovered, after Buffy, I discovered Angel and Felicity and all these things that I had not seen when they had originally aired, and got to sort of sit and watch like 20 hours of, you know, a show in a week where, you know, you'd usually have to wait a whole season, and got really excited by it because I suddenly discovered that that's where all of the character development was happening.
Right. And there's a way of being, I mean, your show is a prime example, but there's a way of being hooked on a show.
Yeah.
That can never happen to in a movie. No matter how wonderful a movie is, you don't get hooked on a movie the way you get hooked on a show where you must come back.
Well, it's not like you watch The Color Purple or something and then go, what happens next with Celie? I can't wait to see it. Right. No, you watch The Color Purple and it's the same every single time. And it's wonderful, but it's the same every single time. But television is fluid, and the characters can grow and change. You can see all the stuff that happens to them, and it feels endless. Even if, you know, a show only does 2 seasons or 1 season or 5 seasons.
It's so many.
It's still so much more than you'd get in a movie in a lot of ways. So for me, that was exciting. And my agent sort of said, what do you want to do next? And I had, I'll be honest, I'd been very sort of lazily laying on the sofa with my baby, living on Crossroads money, you know, living on Britney Spears and Princess Bride, you know, Princess Diaries. Now you make me say Princess Bride.
I'm sorry.
And, you know,
you can put your, Thank you. I'm sorry, I'm like such a hostess. I'm like going, I walked out
with my glass of wine, and then I thought, maybe this isn't appropriate. No, and I thought,
it's appropriate. This whatever. Is vodka. No.
Every time I come here, I'm so kidding. Every time I come here, I trip, and it looks like I've had a lot to drink.
No, you just tripped tonight.
And I don't even drink. And I haven't ever drunk.
Drinked?
I have never drunk here, certainly, but I trip and fall and do bratfalls. Okay. So
say to your agent that you want to...
So
you're living on all that money.
And it was good. You know, DVD money was incredibly... I mean, Britney Spears, go Britney. But I said to my agent, you know, I think maybe I want to do television. And he said, okay. And I went to one meeting at what was then called Touchstone, and now they've changed it to ABC Studios. I don't know why. But they've changed the name and met with Suzanne Patmore, who...
Making it more impersonal.
Yes. Yeah, seriously. To make it clear that they belong to ABC, yeah. I think. But met with Suzanne Patmore, who I had met because she used to do movies, and sort of... She said, do you want to do television? And literally the meeting went like this. Do you want to do television? I said, yeah, I want to do television. She said, okay, let's do some television. And the next thing I knew, I had a development deal. I mean, literally, it was that bizarre. And she set me up. She sent me around to meet some producers. And I went around town and I met a bunch of, you know, big people who were supposed to, I guess, shield me from the forces of television while I was doing this thing. And I went with Mark Gordon and Betsy Beers, and that was fine and great, and pitched a first pilot.
And was this Grey's Anatomy or no?
I pitched a first pilot, and it was about war correspondents. It was about 4 women who reported around the world on wars, and they sort of drank a lot, and they had a lot of sex, and they really enjoyed themselves and were incredibly competitive in their jobs. But then we went to war. I mean, literally, I turned in the pilot and we kind of went to war. And suddenly my sort of charming pilot about people who, you know, drank a lot and had a lot of sex didn't feel so charming while soldiers were dying. And nobody wanted to go anywhere near it, which was fine. I mean, I definitely get it. We went to war.
Right.
And so they said, well, this worked out really well. We really like the script. Do you want to do it again next year? And I said, yeah. But this time I felt like I'm competitive myself. I wanted to make it work. Like, I wanted it to be something that actually
got made.
Yeah, I at least wanted to make a pilot, because I'd sort of gotten the thing in my system that I wanted to do this. And so I said, what are they looking for? And somebody said to me, Bob Iger wants a medical show. And I thought, well, then I'm going to write a medical show. Like, I'm not stupid. And what was great about it was that when I started researching medicine, like, I had always been one of those surgical junkies. I had always...
What does that mean?
Well,
there's a seat for you in the operating theater anytime.
Anytime. No, it was that
like on like the Discovery Channel.
The Discovery Channel and the Learning Channel, they would do those shows like 176-pound tumor. And then they'd show you the tumor and they'd show it being removed. My sisters and I literally would call one another and be like, "They're removing a tumor right now." And we'd watch it together and talk about it, and we're kind of obsessed with it. So I loved that stuff. And I thought, well, if I'm going to do a medical show, I want to do surgery, because surgery seems interesting. And it was a world in which, I mean, coming from the pilot I had just written, where people were incredibly competitive, and they also drank a lot and
right,
had a lot of sex.
That's the connection. I mean, in this, you sent us all this great stuff from your original sort of thoughts and
it
was capturing the intense, the high level of intensity, the pressure that they're under, mm-hmm. right? And that sense of like, you know, who knows who's going to live through this kind of thing.
Absolutely.
And how did she put it? See, naturally, coming from there to here, I lost one page. But that first page had a line that I circled, and I said, well, that's the heart of your show. And it was about like, how do they deal with the complications in their lives while they're it's like they're helping people live, mm-hmm. but their own lives
are, to have a life,
their own life, where is it? And then there was this amazing description. Do you have that document, anybody? But there's that amazing description.
You are not authorized to have that document.
I was perfectly happy for everyone to have the document.
But you had an amazing description of their lives that sounded exactly like what it's like to work on a TV show. It was like they can't get sleep, they don't have,
they spend more time with the people they're working with than
right,
they do
the people
with the people at home.
Yeah, that was interesting for me. The first year of Grey's was just that idea that I actually felt like an intern. I had never worked in television before.
Right.
I had no idea what it was going to be like. I had no idea how many hours. I mean, literally in a movie, you get the assignment. And then sort of 3 or 4 months later, somebody calls and says, how's it going? And you lie and say, oh, I've got a ton of pages. And then 2 weeks before it's due, you turn the whole thing out. Like, it's just very different from working in television. And I had crafts and I did hobbies and I did all this stuff. That I literally have an entire giant craft closet full of things that I like did when I was in movies.
I love crafts and craft closets.
Me and the hot glue gun were very close. But, you know, the minute I started working in television, you are at work all the time. And it's not, I have to say, it wasn't, I expected it to be sort of a culture shock. It was, but it was also amazing because it's so immediate.
Because of the high of, well, you describe beautifully the high that the surgeon has of feeling all that power. And that amazing power of going on the air with this thing that you were just writing like a few minutes ago.
Yeah.
And now it's on the air. The whole country's, you know, into it, and it's immediate. It's that incredible sense of connection.
Well, I remember really vividly the one of the first moments for me was I'd written the pilot, and I wrote interior OR1. There was no R, and there was a gallery above it or something. And literally, you know, they greenlit the pilot. 6 weeks later, I walk into a soundstage, and they have built the OR. And like everything's in it, all of the medical supplies are
all
there.
All the details.
The scalpel's there, the table's there, everything's there. And the director of the pilot, Peter Horton, was sort of walking around trying to figure out what his angles were going to be. And I stood at the operating table with like a scalpel and played like I was a surgeon for like an hour, because I felt like I wrote something in my head.
And it became real.
And it became real.
You know, I always thought of it a little bit like, when you're kids and you're playing with dolls and you imagine this world and then you can change their clothes and put them in the dream house. And to me, like every time I go on a set of something new, I feel like it's like a big doll house and the actors are my dolls. Don't tell them I said that.
But it is true. I mean, there is that sense of, you know, getting to stand in Meredith Grey's house and sort of saying it should look like this or it should look like this or why is the wall over there? And it's amazing. And like I picked everything down to like the books that Meredith has in her bedroom. Like it's like a giant Barbie dream house.
Right,
it
totally is.
It is.
And you know, it's funny because the I wrote down a few things that I wanted to ask you, the 3 pages of things. But you were talking about how there are these characters that are your friends. It almost sounded in this little document I read like in the beginning you saw Meredith Grey as really the person, and but then what's amazing about your show is that it's such a true ensemble. I mean, yeah. It doesn't feel like you really are you're so drawn into every story. There isn't a story you don't want to dip into and keep going with.
I think part of the reason it sounds that way is that the network, at the time, what I was pitching did not sound like a medical show to them, because I kept pitching the love story part of it, and that it was funny, and that they didn't really care about the patients. What they cared about, like, the show was not a show about patients. It was about how our doctors felt about the patients, which at the time, I mean, now it doesn't sound very like a big deal, but at the time felt really radical to everybody. And so part of it was centering it in a way that made it palatable for the network to digest, which was that it was going to be a single female drama.
So you kind of said that to them to help them through it.
Yeah, in a lot of ways to help them through it. And also, I mean, it's true in every episode, other than the ones that aren't narrated by Meredith, you really are watching the world through her eyes.
Right. So, yeah, she is certainly the center of it, and you give the title to her.
But Sandra Oh is just as much a lead as Ellen
right.
Pompeo.
I mean, emotionally, yeah. When you're actually in there watching the show, you're feeling for everybody.
Yeah.
You're involved with everybody.
But this is a question. So if it's through her eyes, but yet you have scenes that she's not in, mm-hmm. is that something that you were sort of thinking about, or is it just the scenes that she's in, or does she have this sort of omniscient?
Because she's the narrator, in a way, there's something that's a little bit omniscient about it. But no, I mean, and it's because she states the theme. But also, you sort of in the beginning, we sort of always began and ended with her. We don't do that anymore, and we I don't think we've done that since
for years.
Since
but you let you
one.
Just let that go naturally.
Yeah, it didn't. It felt like a device as opposed to feeling natural to the show, and it became very clear to us. Even making the pilot, that the show is really about all of these people, and you were just as interested in them as you were in Meredith.
I mean, I think what you're saying is something so important for people that are wondering about writing pilots, that you added a certain twist, not even a twist, you added something to help the network understand it or feel more at ease, but in your own mind, you yeah. knew it wasn't really going to change what you were committed to doing.
Yeah, I sat in the room with the heads of the network and basically said to them, it's Sex and the City, but with medicine, which I had no intention of doing. Like, it wasn't Sex and the City, but with medicine.
But it gave them something to hold on to.
But it definitely gave them something to hold on to. Right. Like, I would have been horrified.
It's like handing a dog a bone.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, like, it was handing them something to help them through figuring out what our show was. And then they started calling it Sex and the Surgery, which made them really happy, which was fine. It meant that I could go away and write and do my own thing and not have to worry about it. So,
I mean, it's funny. You say it isn't that, but on some level, and I'm not saying it is Sex and the City with surgery, but what you have is you're writing romantic comedy.
Yeah, absolutely.
Flat out.
Yeah.
I mean, it's really romantic and it's really funny.
Yeah.
And they're, like, you have this thing here where you say she in her premise, where she's written like the premise of the show. This is, I'm sure, before you wrote the show.
Yeah.
She writes the tone, dramedy, smart characters, smart dialogue. I want this show to be funny and edgy, even though we're dealing with illness and death, even though we are dealing with emotional issues. I don't believe in melodrama, and I don't believe in earnest, sappy moments. So I love that you're kind of making yourself a credo. I mean, you're just going on record going, I mean, your biggest issue is, I'm not going to have it be something I don't like to watch.
That was the only way I knew how to do it. I mean, I think it's an excellent point, because for me, when I was writing it, I'd never written television. I wasn't really comfortable with the 5 and then the 6X structure that the network said to do things in. And I really was just writing something I wanted to see on television. It wasn't about my words are so powerful. It was literally, what do I want to see happen in a show? And because it was that interesting to me, it was so easy to write. I think I wrote this pilot in like 2 or 3 days.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
How much of the original foreign correspondent, war correspondent show, were you able to sort of take and put in this?
I didn't take I took almost nothing from that. I mean, what I took was simply the sense of competition and that I really wanted strong women. Like that, those were the two things that I had been really focused on writing about, was sort of very strong women and a very competitive environment. There was no other sort of story element that went along with it. War Correspondent still exists, and I still fully intend to make it when I have 10 minutes of free time.
I mean, I am so there to watch that show. So let me know when
really,
it's going to be on.
Yeah, I was obsessed.
This document that you have here where you sort of talk about the tone of the show and how you see it, who got that document? Was this just for yourself? Did you give that to the network or the writers or what?
That was the pitch that I made to the network, that original document.
But you didn't hand them this paper.
No, I never hand anybody those papers. I actually found those papers at 5 o'clock this morning.
Wow, so this
around.
Is really
These are in the library for you guys. Yeah. I mean, these are all, you know, now you can always get them.
And you can, or get, you can this, get them. This emailed. Is what you can get on the PDF.
Yeah. So, but I just want to read this. This is the quote. I was looking around and I couldn't find it because I'm a little scattered tonight. I'm so sorry. But it says, what if you're saving 20 lives a week when you can't fix your own life? And to me, that's like you found the question, the key question of the series. And in my mind, like no matter who you hired to write on your staff, you could hand them that sentence
and say, this,
and
is
say
the show.
This is really the show. Yeah. In a funny way, it's got to always come down to that on some level. I mean, that feels like the show.
And it really does. I mean, that's sort of what we started out from and sort of went through the entire time we've been doing it. That's the question we come back to all the time. What's wrong with them and who are they saving?
Right.
That's also, somebody had asked a question before about how do you know if something's a series? If you have a strong, simple idea like that, in a way, that's how you know it's a series too, because then when you're lost, it's like having a compass in the middle of the desert. You're going, oh my God, there's nothing on the horizon but sand.
That's
oh, I've got
your,
a compass.
That's your touchstone.
I know where north is because I've got, last week we had Larry Wilmore here, and his idea for the Bernie Mac show was Bernie Mac sees children as terrorists, and he does not negotiate with terrorists.
Awesome.
And when you look at the show, that's absolutely what the show was.
Yeah.
And so you see that there's this clarity in the compass that
it's
you
very
have to come
simple,
back to.
And yet there's a lot. There's a lot there. It's a very simple question. I'll read it again. So what if you're saving 20 lives a week when you can't fix your own life? It's not that that's a complex question because it raises a lot of questions, other questions, but it's also a very simple issue.
But it also says one sentence, it contains the entire action of the series. You know, every week you're going to be saving lives. Maybe 20, but you're going to be saving lives and your own life is going to have a bunch of problems and complications. And look at that show.
That's the show, no matter how interestingly they depart from different.
It's always that. Well, what's also interesting to me when I was pitching the show, and I'm a really, like, really bad pitcher. I don't like it. And I'm.
Why don't you like it?
Yes, and the thing that's, I'm horribly shy, which doesn't seem true to you guys right now.
It doesn't.
Because I've gotten used to doing this a lot more.
And we plied you with liquor, too.
And I've been plied with liquor.
Does it look like a lot of liquor, though?
Which definitely, but, you know, it helps. But I'm horribly shy and, you know, had been a writer at home and sort of not used to speaking, frankly, to other people. And I'd go to pitch the show. You know, I'd go to pitch a show. I remember pitching War Correspondents and pitching this. Literally, and I was lucky because they bought both of them. But literally, I was the person who I'd have the pitch memorized in my head word for word. I've now learned not to do that. But I have the pitch memorized in my head word for word. And if anybody asked a question, I would completely lose the entire pitch. Like,
just start from the beginning.
Basically, in my head, I'd have to, and they would sit there patiently and wait. And I literally think that Betsy Beers and Mark Gordon sort of said to them, she's kind of autistic, like, don't worry about it. Because everyone very patiently waited for me to, like, get back on track and keep going. But I was so nervous, and I would literally sit on my hands because my hands would be shaking. Because I just wasn't comfortable with the whole idea of it. And I never pitched movies. When I would go in to pitch a movie, I would say things like, I want her to become queen, and I think it's going to be really funny. And that's literally all I'd say, and they'd hire me. Because if you tell someone something's going to be funny, they believe it's funny no matter what you say. Or if you tell them it's sad, they believe it's sad, no matter what you say. I highly recommend that as a pitch technique. You say, it's heartbreaking, and they believe it's heartbreaking, whether or not it actually is.
But can I just ask a question just on their, for their point of view? I mean, when you were going in and pitching those movies, even before Grey's This Is, like, did you have, like, a kick-ass, like, thing that you had written that got you all those meetings?
Yeah, I mean, the thing is I had written a script coming out of film school, my thesis script, which was a very dark, small movie about a girl whose brother was found dead in a cornfield, and she kept trying to bury him. It was really dark. But it was incredibly well written, and it got me an agent, and it was Antigone in a cornfield, and they didn't really have anything like it. And it was sort of at the time when the indie films were like the huge thing. And it got me a lot of meetings, and it got me an agent, and it got me in the door a lot of places. And my agent, I remember my agent very clearly saying to me, that's great that you've written that. Now write something completely different so that people know that you can do something completely different. And so I had sort of a crappy job that I hated doing. And I would go
what
to my
What was the job? Do you mind my asking?
I will, but now you're going to make me seem like a bad person.
No.
I worked at a place that helped the mentally ill homeless learn job skills and find places to live.
Okay, that is good on so many levels. Because, I mean,
sorry, I don't know what made me ask you that. I thought she just blew past it so fast.
I just have to pause and say that must have given you a lot of material. No? I mean,
it did. I mean, I think also it made me feel like I was this far from being mentally ill and homeless and needing, you know, having a job. I mean, seriously, there was just that feeling of, if this doesn't work out, literally, I really felt like I have no plan B. I'm going to write this second script, and if this doesn't work out, I'm going someplace else and doing something else.
So what was the second script?
So the second script was a romantic comedy, and it was I have to say, it was fairly calculated on my part. I really thought about it. I really looked at what was out there. And I'd never really done that before, written something where you look at the marketplace and try to figure out what's interesting and then write something. And I think the reason it worked was because I figured out what was interesting about it to me. And so I wrote a romantic comedy about an older white woman who fell in love with a younger black man when she answered the wrong personals ad. And I told everybody it was for Will Smith and Susan Sarandon.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
And it sold.
I'm going to try that.
In less than 24 hours, which was amazing.
But I love. What you said just now has been our mantra that we keep repeating for every night of the class, which is that you made it interesting for you. You
yeah.
found a way, you wanted to write it, but you found a way in that made it compelling for you.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's smart to look at what's out there and to look at what people are looking for, but I also think that it's useless to you if what you're writing isn't also interesting. Like, you have to find
to
a way.
You. To
yeah,
you.
Yeah, to you. You have to find a way to have something that you dream about at night in order to get something out into the marketplace that's good. It's fine to try to serve the marketplace, but I think it makes a lot of bad movies. And they buy some of those, but then you feel bad about them. But if you feel passionate about something, and the script was called Human Seeking Same, which was actually...
Great title.
It was a personals ad that I saw in the newspaper, which
that's
I thought was fascinating.
That's a great title.
What happened to that? It sounds like such a good movie.
It yeah. sold. This is also, I thought, the most wonderful thing about the movie industry at the time. It sold once. And right after it sold, I got hired to write Dorothy Dandridge. And I did all the rewrites that they asked for. And then they were like, well, you know, the only person who could be in this role is Will Smith. So they put it in turnaround. And then it sold again. And they said, well, the only person who could be in this movie is Will Smith. And then it sold again. So I sold it three times, which was great.
It was good for you, in a
sense. Very good for me.
But was it always, was Will Smith just always super busy?
Well, here's what's interesting is that Will Smith was attached to executive produce my other dark little tiny movie.
Oh, funny.
That I was doing. And I kept saying, you know, Will Smith's right here. And it felt like nobody thought they could get him because he was doing all these huge, huge movies. And he actually wasn't ready at the time to do a romantic comedy. Later he was, but at the time it just seemed like he wasn't ready to do a romantic comedy. And so I also think that, you know, he didn't want to do a romantic comedy that was an interracial romantic comedy right away, which I totally got and respected.
Right.
But it just ended up being put in turnaround for a while, which was fine. And then I got it back eventually.
And you own it?
Yeah.
I want to see that movie.
Yeah, I want to see that.
I mean, seriously.
You know what? What's interesting is it's charming, and I look at it now, and it was so innocent in so many ways because I was such a kid when I wrote it in terms of also just what I thought was romantic.
But can I, all right, now we're on the subject, because I have a whole section here where I want to talk about kissing, and I want to talk about, no, serious, because what I really get off your show on some level is that if I had to say one thing about you as a writer, I feel like you're amazing in writing romance. I mean, just amazing. And you find, most people I think can't write romantic comedy convincingly, and you find situations that are truly romantic, but not in a cookie cutter way, that are truly, it's very much, I feel like if I didn't know a woman wrote it, I would sense it, because that's why I brought up the subject of kissing, because it's like you're very focused in your writing on like the kiss, you know?
Yeah.
The kiss, the moment, like that kiss when that he sweeps into the bar with and kisses her after all those, kisses Izzy when after all that time that he didn't kiss her.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, there's like the kiss, like the setting of the kiss and the occasion of the kiss and what makes it.
And Derek wearing blue while they're kissing. Yeah, it's all very.
What makes it
special? I hear that guys stand around in locker rooms and say, so did you kiss her yet?
I mean, obviously this is I just lost every man in the room. They just like disappeared. But I mean, this is obviously a female like passionate concern is the kiss. You do it in a way that's unique. You always, to me, you find some way in that's really sexy and really funny too. And there's just something about that I'm charmed by you saying you had never written romantic comedy before. It's like, until that movie, it's like, to me, that's your natural, that's like your natural in the pocket place to go.
Yeah, I always had this picture in my head. I mean, I never thought I was going to write movies. I'd always thought I was going to write sort of dark, small novels set in like 1930s South. Literally, like I really wanted to be Toni Morrison.
Right.
And really believe that if I worked hard enough, I would be her. But not going to happen. And that's fine. But I really thought that that's what I was going to do after college. And I sort of went away to try to do that. And that didn't really work. And went to film school. And then sort of.
Where did you go to film school?
USC. Just curious. For grad school.
And what was that experience like in a general? I mean, was that fulfilling? Was that frustrating? What was that?
It was interesting. My father is the CIO of USC, so I'm not going to say anything bad.
He is?
Yeah. He wasn't then, but he is now. It's kind of awesome.
So is that like a Meredith Grey-like moment?
It's a little bit like that. It's very strange.
Wow.
But the thing that I learned in film school was that you pay a lot of money to, and it was a great training ground, I have to say, but you pay a lot of money for the contacts. To be able to say that you went to USC and then to be able to have the contacts afterwards.
Right.
And granted, going to USC got me my attorney, who then got me my agent and all of those things. But the thing that I felt most strongly when I was there was if you couldn't write when you got there, you weren't going to be able to write when you got out. So either you can write or you can't. And they can teach you some skills and they can teach you some things, but nobody can teach you how to write. And I think a lot of people go to film school because they think it's going to teach them how to write. And that never is going to happen.
Right. Right. I mean, I think that's so right on. But also you can be I've talked about this briefly. We've both talked about this, that you can, if you're feeling particularly flipped out or lost, you can be placed in an environment. You can place yourself in an environment, almost like going into lockdown or something, where you're in a competitive atmosphere where you are asked to write a certain amount and hand it in and sort of show what you wrote. And that can dig something out of you.
And I have to say what was interesting about film school was it was the first time, I mean, I was a creative writing major at Dartmouth. And so to me, film school was about standing up in front of a bunch of people and hearing what they thought about what you wrote, which is an amazing training ground for a lot of things because.
Well, certainly for dealing with the network. I mean.
I don't think anything's a training ground for dealing with the network. But it definitely is. It definitely is sort of the first time you're sort of put out there, kind of naked, and have your work commented upon in a way that doesn't happen in sort of an Ivy League academic classroom. it's a real workshop of sorts. And it was the first time I'd written something and then actors would get up and say those lines. And that was partly being a real workshop of sorts. And we'd film some of the scenes and you'd see what would work in a scene and what wouldn't. It was a great training ground for that. Definitely.
Well, you had never, as a creative writing major in Dartmouth, you had not had actor, you had not been living that life of writing for an actor.
No, I actually had been doing theater in college.
Oh, and
I was
okay.
A director. I directed a whole bunch of plays. So it wasn't, and I'd never written any. It never occurred to me to write any. It just didn't, I was going to write esoteric dark novels. But I directed a lot of plays. So I had worked with actors from that end. And I had taken acting classes, and I had done the writing from the fiction end, but I'd never actually written anything
you
that an
actor
was going to say.
You never put that together.
No.
Right. And then when you put that together, did you kind of go, wow?
Yeah. It's a little bit like it's a drug. I mean, I have to say, it is its own drug to sort of write something and then hear somebody speak those lines. And it's still one for me every single week to write something. I mean, I sneak down to set all the time just to hear Shonda Wilson do a monologue that we've written for her, or to see what Sandra Oh is going to do with some line that I've given her, because I know it's going to be amazing, or to watch Meredith and Derek kiss. I mean, I do it all the time, and it's fantastic.
And do you sometimes sort of go like, wow, that is really, I mean, in other words, that moment when you were writing it and putting yourself into that romantic moment, I mean, does it sometimes just go, oh, wow, that really is how I pictured it, and that's...
Yeah, the thing that I was sort of going to say earlier about why I like television better than movies for my own purpose is that where movies are not what you see in your head, television is all what I see in my head. What's amazing about television for me is that I write something and literally the thing that I write comes out on screen. That is amazing. I mean, it's just an amazing creative moment to sort of go, I hope it looks like this, or I hope it sounds like this, and it does. Like, it's great.
I wanted to ask you something, because Winnie brought up the kiss thing, and I'm just really curious if you're conscious of, do you feel that this is your opportunity to have romance as you would like it to be, or do you feel like it reflects certain things that you've experienced? I mean, I'm just curious, because it is a world where it feels like the men are behaving in a way that women kind of wish they would behave.
Yeah, I mean, the joke on the show is that all the men, except for George, because he was one of the original interns, All the interns are some piece of my personality. And all the men are as I wish men would be. I mean, it's the joke, but it's also the truth. We constantly sit at table reads, and the guys read lines, and they say amazing things, and... My favorite is when Burke says his wedding vows to the operating room that he's going to say to Christina. And I'd written that speech, and I sat in the room, and he said the vows at the table while we were doing the table read. And I put my head down on the table, and I said, this is how come I'm never going to get married. Because no man ever says the dialogue that I wanted to say in my head. Like it's always disappointing. And I get to write stuff and have, Derek and Burke and Denny, who's dying beautifully. Like, I get to write stuff and have them say it.
I mean, that was just like Wuthering Heights, man. You know, that was like killer. That was just...
I was so in love with Denny. Not the actor. Like, literally, the actor didn't exist for me. Like, he almost wasn't allowed to talk to me. I was so in love with Denny that it was shameful. Like, I joked on the blog that he should have had, like... a restraining order that I couldn't come within 50 feet because I was so in love with
him. Of the fictional character. Yeah. Now, did you regret, killing him off?
Well, he was brought on to die. I mean, the board at the beginning of season two said, like, literally the first thing on the board said, dying young man comes in, dying man young dies young. Like, I knew that's what was going to happen. And it was fine. And I talked to him about it when we hired him, and we all knew that's what was going to happen. And still, like, when I wrote the script... where he died, I cried like a baby. I mean, because it was so real to me.
While you were writing?
Yeah, it was so, it sounds sappy. Guys, I'm sorry.
No, but that's in the scene.
It was so real to me when she's lying in that bed and sort of saying, I can't believe he's gone. And then when we read it at the table read, I cried and Denny cried and Izzy cried and we all cried. And then when we shot the scene, we kept having to stop shooting because I was crying really loudly. Really, I mean, so and I'm not that person. Like, I'm not that sappy person. I was crying really loudly.
Yeah, well, it says here, like, I don't believe in earnest sappy moments, but
no.
But I have to say, to defend you, since you're you're evoking the sappy word, it wasn't sappy, but what it was is you went there. Like, you took an incredible situation that you came up with, which is an incredibly, incredibly rich idea to have her.
You could have written him a cure.
Yeah.
And you just went all the way.
As Jeffrey Dean Morgan, the actor, kept saying to me, he's like, "Aren't you? You could save me. At any minute, you could save me." And I kept being like, "I'm so sorry. You have to die."
It's adorable.
And then when we edited it, I was devastated. And then I went into the writer's room and cried there. And like it was kind of ridiculous. Like, the head of the network called me and said, "Great work." And I cried there. It felt wrong, and yet it felt like exactly what needed to
happen.
But
you knew if you were having that reaction, then the audience would also have that reaction, and that's great. You know, you want to make people cry.
And it also shows your level, to me, it shows your level of commitment. I mean, in other words, that's part of the power of the scripts you're turning out, that the storylines you're telling, which is that you go there with them, you believe in them.
Yeah, I always feel like if I don't believe the storyline that we're telling, then we shouldn't be telling it. As somebody who, people used to say to me, like, do you save stories for another season? Do you hear pitches in the room, think they're great, and go, oh, that's for the next season? No. We, for the first season of Grey's, we threw it all out there because I felt like we might make 13 and never make any more. So we threw it all out there. We threw everything I had in my head out there onto this screen. And then the season two, we did exactly the same thing. And for season three, we did exactly the same thing. And for season four, we're doing exactly the same thing. Because if not, like, you're holding back for I don't know what. Like,
what are you waiting for?
You're banking stuff when you should be using the drama that you're feeling right now.
I love what you're saying. I mean, to me, that's like saying, I believe that in abundance. I believe that there will be more where that came from. It's like, if I'm saving it, I'm telling myself there isn't enough. I probably won't have enough good ideas. I better save them. And it's like a constricted stance. Whereas if you use them, man, then it's like you go. It's like breastfeeding. I mean, it's like you go, I'm gonna like give it all. Because
that's for the guys who were missing the kissing conversation.
Yeah, this is the night that I alienate every man in the room. And I don't often do that, but I. As you can see, do it very well when I want to. No, it's just, I think that's a great stance. I have never heard somebody really put it that way.
Well, it's also, I mean, I love, it's hoarding, but it's also, this is going to alienate the men in a whole other way, but it's like that thing where if you're clinging on to something, there's no room for anything else to come in, and it's kind of like moving the energy. It's sort of like letting it go and creating space for more stuff to come in.
And it wasn't even that, I come in it for the guys. I come in it from a very guy way. I was like, this is a war. I mean, for me, this is a war. Like, we're fighting the ratings, and you're fighting the networks, and you're fighting to get an audience. When you're fighting a war, you don't say, well, we have these missiles, but we're going to save them. you don't do that. Like, that's how you die. You fire your missiles when you've got them. And for me, it was about sort of doing that. Like, we're putting it all out there on the page. And my writing staff, who had been on show after show, they'd been really seasoned. And I really sort of love and respect them for sort of taking me in and going, okay, she's never done television before. She's a TV baby, and she's telling us what to do. We're all going to listen. But I just kept saying, like, we have to throw it all out there now because you don't know. You just don't know if there's going to be another season. And at the end of season one, I remember sitting down with the network and them saying, okay, what do you have planned for season two? And it was like 3 days after we'd finished season one. And I said, I have no idea. And they were like, how can you have no idea? I have no idea what we're going to do for season two because I used everything I have for season one. And I need to go away for a week and think and figure out something that we're going to do for season two. And I think they were all a bit scared. But it managed to work.
I love that you had the authenticity at that point to not lie, to not fake it.
Yeah.
I mean, it's so good. I mean,
I was just really tired.
Yeah, too. You were tired. Right. Yeah, you couldn't even fake it.
And the show was a big hit.
Yeah, it was a big hit.
It's at the end of season one, we were a hit.
It was huge.
Well, at the end of season, it's hard for me to say that. We were sort of working so hard and so in the bubble of working on the show that it took me until the end of season two to realize that the show was a hit at all, to realize that anybody was even watching, even post-Super Bowl, any of that. It took me to the end of season two to realize anybody was watching.
Wow.
Yeah.
Well, because you were busy and you were involved.
I was busy and I was involved. And it wasn't until they brought us to the upfronts for season two. Season one, we'd gone to the upfronts. And, well, for the pilot, we'd gone to the upfronts and nobody paid attention. I mean, literally, we were the people stuffed in the corner and all the actors were there and everybody just kept walking past them and asking them to get them drinks. At the end of season one, we went to the upfronts and people were nice and polite, but they still said, get out of the way. Like, the Desperate Housewives are over here. We'd like to talk to them. At the end of season two, we went to the upfronts and it was so surprising to all of us because we'd all been working so hard. We caused a riot, like with the advertisers who were sort of taking the pictures. And they had to surround the cast with 8 bodyguards. It was bizarre. And we were all a little bit freaked out by it. But it was the first time I went, I think people are watching this.
Will you talk a little bit? I've heard that the network really didn't know what they had. And when they looked at the show. So can you talk a little bit about what the reaction was to the pilot and just sort of what the journey was? The first season, it was just 13 episodes?
Yeah, we did 13 mid-season.
And then you came back, so mid-season. So can you just talk a little bit about that and what the experience was like with the network and all that?
I don't think it was that the network didn't know what they had. It was a very interesting time at ABC because Steve McPherson was the head of the studio when we did the pilot. And really didn't have much to do with the making of our pilot in the sense of he wasn't, you know, he was running the studio. He wasn't the person giving us notes. And there were a bunch of women who were working on the pilot who were very passionate about the development of the pilot. At the time the pilot got picked up, Steve was moving from being the head of the studio to the head of the network. So the executives and the head of the network who had picked up the pilot and loved the pilot and greenlit the pilot were now moving on someplace else, which was heartbreaking. But Steve sort of said, and he said it at the beginning, and this is why I really respect him. He sort of said, I don't get this as a show. Like, I don't get it. But the women who work for me are yelling and screaming at me when I say that maybe we shouldn't pick this up. So, I there's value in it. Let's pick it up. And so we picked it up, and then he went ahead and put it on the air, which, you know, he didn't have to do as a mid-season show. You didn't necessarily have to do. And then he stuck with it. And I would write these storylines, and he would call and say, really, like, this is what you want to do? And I'd be like, yes, and I feel really passionately about it, and here's why there should be, like, 5 acts of kissing and blah, 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 blah. And he would say, okay. And it actually worked out really well because what was good about it was whether or not it was a show that he as a guy would watch, he absolutely respected the fact that I was really passionate about it and felt really strongly about it and that the women around him were excited about it as well.
Isn't there a lesson there for us maybe to, you know, because I think it's tempting. I mean, it's tempting to lose heart if somebody in an authority position is saying, I just don't get it, I just don't get it. You know, not in a mean-spirited way, but just honestly, I just don't get it. And you did get it. And you knew in your heart that this was like the best you could do, and it was really cool.
Yeah, I mean, that first season, we made the first season, and I remember sort of saying we finished shooting the 13th episode the night after we aired. And I remember saying to her, like, for the very first time. So we aired for the very first time.
Wow.
We got the numbers and didn't know what they meant because we'd never done television before. And I remember saying to Betsy,
Were you after Desperate Housewives?
We were after Desperate Housewives. But, you know, the show that had previously been on after Desperate Housewives had done sort of like a 4 or something like that, and we were doing like an 8. And I just didn't know what the numbers meant, and I didn't know what to expect. But I remember saying to Betsy that night that it aired, if nobody watches the show, if we don't get picked up and we don't air another episode, let's sell it out of the back of our car because it's really good. And really feeling that was true, like being really proud of the work that I had done and feeling like those 13 episodes were the best 13 episodes we could have ever done and couldn't possibly do any better. And that made it okay.
Totally. That makes everything okay.
Yeah.
I mean, that's all you need.
Yeah, and it helped because I was terrified. In the beginning, I was terrified of Steve, and I was terrified of the network, and I was terrified of the whole process because it felt like there were these people who could shut you down at any moment. And now we have sort of a really great, amazing relationship that's really supportive. But it was about me fighting for what I wanted and them sort of fighting back and us respecting each other that made it work.
So I'm just curious because I have, you know, this is a challenging thing for me. How do you fight for what you want without appearing to be closed-minded or being impossible, or do you know what I mean? I mean, or maybe it's okay to appear closed-minded and impossible at times. No. I really don't know. It's a real question. Like I don't feel like this is a strong suit of mine. Yeah. So I'm asking.
I'm trying
for
to think
advice.
About that. I don't know. I mean, I have to say that the first year there were times that were really hard because my response, and maybe this is a good response, I don't know. My response to I don't care. My response to what I'd call a stupid note from the network is always silence. It's just because my whole thing is if you don't have something nice to say, you don't say anything at all. So they'd give me a note that I would find horrifying, like really horrifying. Like, can all the women just be nicer? Can Meredith and Christina just hug? And my response was always, you know, you'd be on the phone and it'd be at this big conference call. And my response would always just be total silence because there was nothing I could think of to say that wouldn't be insulting. And in that silence, what would happen for me, and still does, is after a minute or two, when they're wondering if you're still on the line, it gets filled in with nervous chatter because they're just as scared as you are. I mean, that's the reality.
Right.
They're just as scared that
maybe
they don't,
more.
Yeah, they're just as scared that they don't know what they're talking about. And what you have on your side is that you have the vision. It gets filled in with this very...
And talent.
Well, at the very least, you feel like I know what I was trying to achieve.
Exactly.
So it gets filled in with this nervous chatter on their part that sort of comes around to something. And then it enabled me, in that silence, to try to figure out what it is that they were trying to say. Because I think even the note that sounds the most stupid note, mm-hmm. is a note that is coming from something. No matter what the note is. I mean, and sometimes they're painful. Sometimes they're really painful. But every note has a point. There's something underneath it that they're responding to. They may not have a way to express it. They may not have a way to verbalize what they're trying to say. But if you really let them talk long enough, you will figure out what it is that is the problem.
I don't mean to put you on the spot, but can you think of any examples of that? Just sort of to give people an idea of, you know, for example, like, you know, the thing where they always want people to hug.
Well, she said, what they're saying can't they all be nicer? And yeah, I had notes like that, too. It's interesting. I mean, that's a real thing that people.
Yeah, it's a real
women,
thing.
Someone in the front said for women. I think that is a real thing for
women.
Yeah,
nobody ever wanted the men to be nicer to one another. But it was very interesting to me that in the first season, I'm trying to think of a specific example.
While you're thinking, the one that pops to me is my very first movie. I think I told I pitched and sold and wrote a movie. It was my first movie job, and they were always talking ever since my first draft of how neurotic. Does she have to be so neurotic? Does she have to be so neurotic? And there was always that word, and it was just driving me crazy because I had really just flat out written myself. And it just bothered me so much.
Does she have to be so pathetic?
They never said pathetic. No, they might have even. But yeah, but they said neurotic, and it was like, and then, you know, I wanted to scream, you know, yeah, like, because you hired me and I'm like so neurotic and it's going to come out this neurotic every time. You know, why don't you hire ring the bell for mental health and it'll become like all cleaned up. I mean, you just want to die because yeah. they're actually insulting you so much more than they even know.
Yeah, I don't want to say like the third or the fourth, I don't remember which it was. We did this big episode in our first season in which a man comes in, he dies without us ever having really known him. He's brain dead without us ever having really known him. And then we transplant all his organs out. And there's a moment in that episode in which Izzy is standing there and she's saying, this is so sad. And Christina basically says, I wish you would just go into the light already so I could just go and get on another surgery. And the network was horrified. I mean, there were conference calls about this line. How could a doctor want somebody to go into the light already? And isn't that mean? And isn't that cruel? And I was like, And what's funny is when I wrote the line.
Had a sense of humor.
Well, when I wrote the line, it's literally something that I would have said.
Right, right.
It's literally something that I would have said. So I felt, I took it personally that they were calling her like cruel and without a soul and she's a sociopath because she doesn't care about anybody. And what it really came down to is they were afraid that our doctors wouldn't seem like they cared. And I kept saying, obviously they care. They're here.
Really?
Like you wouldn't be a doctor if you didn't care.
They don't sleep. They don't eat.
This is what they want to do for a living. So there's something underneath it for all of them. They don't all have to be nice about it. And there's nothing wrong with it. And I remember getting that note and sort of sitting silently and hearing finally that what was underneath it was is they were worried that our doctors didn't care. And then I just sort of sat and pointed out to them sort of 50 instances in the script in which the doctor showed they cared and said, I'm not going to change the line because I feel like it's self-evident for you guys. And they let it go. But that would happen on a script-by-script basis for me for the entire first season.
That's pretty maddening. I mean, I'm not complaining. You got through it. I love how you got through it.
I love the idea of being silent. I'm going to have to try
that. I'm
going
to have to try that, too. I actually think that that's brilliant. I mean, that never occurred to me, as you can tell.
Well,
I talk
because,
so much,
because the instinct is to fill the, you know, they say something, and then you respond to prove to them why they're wrong. And for me, I always just felt like, A, I don't have the words fast enough to prove to you why you're wrong. I'm too busy being horrified that you said what you said. And B, what wants to come out of my mouth is a string of really foul things. So I'm just going to sit quietly until that passes.
Right.
I mean, really, that was my attitude.
That is
my version of it is just to go, you know, that's interesting. Can I think about that? Or tell me more about that? Or, you know, just something that is non-committal.
And that is the warmer, smarter way to go, frankly.
But you want to try the silent
thing.
Silence
is cool because they're...
I want to see if they bail. Like if you're just silent,
I think
if they
it's
just
powerful.
Bail on themselves.
I think it's powerful.
I feel bad giving this advice because I don't want anybody to try it and then like get fired or something. But
don't worry. Me, I mean, we'll all use
I just try and be passive aggressive. That's what works for me.
But I have to say that it did work for me that first season. I also, you know, I was really innocent about television. It never occurred to me that they could fire me off my own show my first season. Never occurred to me. So I behaved as if they couldn't possibly fire me off my own show my first season. People would say to me, you've got to do that. And I'd say, no, we're not doing that. The executives would come to the editing room and I'd be like, you have to get out because you're messing with my process. And because I was so sort of innocent about it, I really wasn't being passive aggressive or aggressive aggressive. I was stating the facts as I knew them, like, get out, I'm doing something. And they would go. And so it worked for me.
But I don't want to get all secret on us, but I really think like that you were creating your own reality. No, come on. Like you were seriously creating your own reality because you were, because in other words, you were saying you didn't believe you could get fired because you didn't know it was possible. We're talking about, you said beginner's mind, but that's a form of beginner's luck. Like what
beginner's mind or beginner's luck?
Well, beginner's luck, which I think is related to beginner's mind by marriage or something, is beginner's luck has a psychological component and a spiritual component that I think is very real, which is that if you don't, beginner's luck to me says that there are certain things you don't even know can go wrong.
Right.
So therefore you behave with a kind of incredible courage and bravado. Not bravado, that's the wrong word. You behave with a kind of healthy arrogance because you have no idea that certain things can trip you up or become a problem.
Yeah,
that's how little you know. But that not knowing is right before you came on. We were talking a little bit about denial as in a positive way. That there are negative forms of denial, but that for instance in show business, denial can be your friend.
Yes.
And you know if you take in every fact of why it's probably true that such and such won't go well, you know that's not really a healthy. You might say, oh, I'm in touch with reality. You know, I'm really reading the trades every day and seeing how well off other people are and how terribly I'm doing. You know, but you don't, if you're in denial about that, that's actually a healthier place to be on some level.
That's why I don't read the trades, yeah.
I don't read the trades either. And I love that you said, I didn't even know I could be fired. And I was telling people that you have to leave. And I was saying to people, you can't do this and you can't do that with utter conviction. Because to me, what you made that true, you then couldn't be fired because you were just making it so. I mean, that's brilliant.
After the pilot, I remember them saying to me, I myself was personally writing, like, I think the first four episodes or something like that. And I was writing them out of order, and people were writing in the middle, and it was a whole thing. And they kept saying to me, well, when are you going to have outlines? And because I was writing so many episodes at the time, because I was stupid enough to think I could write a lot at a time, because I was writing so many episodes at the time, I just said, well, you know, I don't write outlines. It's counterintuitive to my process. And it was literally just something I said on the fly. And they all sort of went, okay. So from that moment on, I've never had to write an outline for the network, not for anything, not for anything anywhere at any time. And it's just an accepted rule. I was just like, I can't write that way. It's just so bad. And it worked.
Well, so that, did I interrupt you?
Yeah.
That leads me to a really good question, I think, which is that if you don't like to write outlines, how do you sit down and begin? It's time to start, and you needs to start. What do you do first?
I'm writing the finale for Grey's now, and it's a 2-hour gigantic thing that won't go away. But I'm going to use it as an example, because for me, things sometimes start with just an image, or TV Guide TV Guide asked me to write a guest column for them about what this season was going to hold and how the season was going to end and the whole thing. And really, I hadn't even begun seriously thinking about the finale at that point. I always know the end point of a season when I start it, but I hadn't really begun thinking about it. And when I sat down to write the article, part of what the article did was make me go, oh my God, I have so many threads that have to be tied up in this episode. And I wrote in the article, the entire season ends with a kiss, really sort of bravely. The entire season ends with a kiss. And then a week ago, somebody brought me the article, and they were like, the entire season ends with a kiss. And I remember thinking, I'm so screwed, because I haven't started writing yet, and I've already said the entire season ends with a kiss, and I know how it ends, but clearly there's going to have to be some kissing going on, and I don't know what to do. But part of it is sort of, honestly, I know people have a lot of process. I was talking to Alan Heinberg, who's one of the writers on our show, and he has a very intense, very intricate, very engaged process that involves a lot of stuff. And he's written
he's
on stuff from...
He's a friend of ours, you know?
Yeah, he's a friend of yours, and he's written on stuff like The O.C. and Sex and the City, and he's on Grey's, and he's been there for 3 seasons, and we love him. And his process is very different from mine. Like, he plans stuff out and spends time writing on boards and very little tiny writing and gives out lots of documents, and it's great for him. I am a person who I sit in the room and... I'll use, because I can't talk about the finale of this season, I just realized, but the finale of season 2, I'll use that as an example. I sit in a room and I say, Izzy's going to be in bed with Denny's dead body, and she's going to be devastated. And that, to me, is how the entire season laid out. Like, I started the season thinking that, and then all season long, little things would come. And those little things are things that, like, I sort of gather up in my head, and I don't ever really write them down. I gather them up in my head, and I think about them for a long time. And then pretty soon, our line producer, Rob Korn, is saying to me, we're going to prep your script next week. And I've sort of bravely told the network, the finale is going to be great. Don't you worry about it. I've got it all under control. And I really, I honestly have no idea until I sit down at the computer and take all those little things that are in my head and realize that they've turned into something. And for me, it's because the characters are so real and because I know exactly who they are. Because that, I think, is the big problem. One of the things that I think I use as an example is on Private Practice, we started, like, I had a pilot before I even knew how to pilot, I had a show before I even knew how to show. And we were writing characters before we even knew who they were completely. And
this is on Private Practice.
This is on Private Practice. We're writing, and it's a process, and we're, you know, you're still learning it. But on Grey's, like, those people were, they were completely real. In Private Practice, I was sort of, Addison was real and everybody else was springing up around her and sort of growing, and I was learning about them as I was going. But because I really knew the characters on Grey's, like, I could tell you what shoes Meredith would wear in any given day. I could tell you what Christina eats for breakfast. Because I knew those characters so well, when I sit down to write something, I know what they're going to say. I just know what they're going to say. And planning the episodes isn't about writing on little boards for me as much as it is lying on the floor feeling bad that I have to write it all.
But what about, like, I mean, that's, I'm curious about this. Like, when you brought in a character, like, when you bring in Addison,
mm-hmm.
when you first brought her in,
Did you know from the beginning, oh, he's married to a woman who adultery?
Yes.
You always knew that?
Yes. Patrick didn't, but I did, yeah.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
So when you brought her in and she become, I mean, didn't she surprise you, though? Did you always know she was going to become that character that she became?
No, I thought we were going to keep her for, I think it was 7 episodes. And then I thought she was going to go away.
So what then happened within you as a writer? Did you just fall in love with writing her?
Yeah, as a writer on a television show, I spend a lot of time in the editing room. A large part of the writing process is I write something and then I go and I watch it in the editing room, or one of our writers writes something and I go and watch it in the editing room. And I edit every episode with the editor. Like, I sit with the editor on every episode.
It's really like your final draft.
It's definitely my final draft. All of our scripts are a little bit long. Everything gets honed in the editing room. Every once in a while I'll see something in the editing room and go back and say, we have to reshoot this for this. I need this little moment. Can Lexi do this in the corner here so that we can get something? So for me, part of it is I write something, I go watch how it plays out. That gives me ideas, and then I go back to write something, and then I watch how it plays out, and that gives me more ideas. Because it is a collaboration. Like, you can write all the lines in the world, but you have no idea how your actors are going to play them, and you have no control over that. Not the way people think you have control over it. You know, Patrick will do something magical, and that magical thing will make me think, oh, maybe this happens, or maybe this happens. And he and Addison had a chemistry that was interesting to me.
Right.
And she was sort of giving as good as she got, and that was interesting to me. And watching that in the editing room made me sort of go back and think, how can I play this out a little bit more?
So, like, always so grateful, too, when you're doing a series and something, you know, you have plan is 7 episodes, she's serving this purpose in the triangle,
yeah,
she's the obstacle, whatever it was, and then you see something and you're going, oh, thank God, I have so many ideas for her, you know,
yeah,
that there's it's more. Gonna give me somewhere to go and something to play.
Yeah, she was, you know, a really interesting character, and finding those interesting characters is half the battle. I mean, it's not always the way you think it's gonna go. It just isn't.
Can I ask you, this is something that keeps coming up in my brain, which is how much, it sounds like you were on a parallel track to interns going into this situation. You had some knowledge and some experience that was somewhat relevant to what you were doing, but in other ways you were completely in over your head. You know, there's that thing in the pilot where it's like one thing to think about doing surgery and working on cadavers,
yeah,
and then really being there, and then who rises to the occasion and who doesn't, and then also just this sort of idea of lying on the floor and wishing, you know, feeling like I wish I didn't have to do this, and just this sort of idea of the tired interns.
There's some other job I could do,
right? And yeah. and are you consciously aware of, like, using your feelings at the moment and giving them to the doctors, or are those on parallel tracks, or, you know what I'm saying?
I don't even know that part is conscious. I mean, I've never really thought about that part of it before, like my misery at having to live
but
up to any
expectations
whatsoever.
But you see all the connections,
yeah,
right?
I mean, yeah, I do.
They're amazing.
I do. I think it might have been the pilot where George says, you know, I wish I wanted to be a fireman,
yeah,
or a mail carrier or something else.
Yeah.
And I always wish I wanted to be a librarian. Like, that seems like an awesome job, and I really wish I desperately wanted to do that as opposed to doing this.
Because it seems so safe?
It seems like it's easier, and it seems like nobody lives or dies and the books are already written. Like, to me, there's something kind of lovely about that. But yeah, you feel like that panic definitely translates into the characters. And I don't necessarily feel like I'm conscious of using it. It just happens.
Maybe it's just an intuitive thing that,
yeah,
you do. That, I mean, I'm still blown away by your, I didn't know this about you, that your first movie that got you all the attention was not a romantic comedy.
No,
that
it
just
was
blows
very
me
dark
away.
13-year-old
it's
girl
like
cornfield. Yeah.
I mean, obviously that's a whole other side of you.
Yeah.
And that is a side that gets exercised in Grays.
I was going to say, I feel like
there's plenty of that.
A lot of darkness in Grays.
Absolutely.
It's very interesting to me because people always say it's funny and it's light. And I was really shocked when we started doing season 3 and people were saying, like, it's so dark. I was like, Denny just died. Like, Izzy went crazy and cut his LVAD wire, stole a heart, and killed him. Like, that's not romance. It's scary. like, to me, there's definitely a darkness, and Meredith always definitely had a very dark underbelly to her with her mother and everything that had gone on with that. So to me, the show was really much darker than that. I think that there's a part of me that's a romantic that I didn't even know existed, and there's a part of me that sort of feels like this is the way I wish the way the world was, and this is the way the world is. And that darkness has always been in the show.
I also think that it's what makes it feel lifelike, because, you know, going back to that line that you fought with them over, you know, why doesn't it go to the light already? That's how those people really talk. This is what they do every day, all day long, business as usual, dark humor. I mean, the things that are said in a writer's room under stress, under pressure, are
horrific.
Vile, yeah. Horrific,
mean,
yeah. All of that. And it's part of what makes it feel real. And what I like about the show is this hard juxtaposition. See, I think in addition to the comedy, what makes it feel like a romantic comedy is how it's paced.
Yeah.
It's like that feeling of almost like, you know, His Girl Friday, that kind of thing where it's paced up and like people are talking in a way that you sort of talk in real life when you're going really fast and it's really intense.
And what I like is that we can go from sort of that kind of humor to a very dark moment in the very next scene. I always say there's no sort of, what's the word?
Transition?
There's no template. Sorry.
Oh, there's no template.
Wine. There's no template for Grey's Anatomy. There's no episode that says, like, this is what Grey's Anatomy is. This is what will be every episode. This is what you can count on and expect.
The pace changes, you're saying.
The pace changes. We do wildly different things on a, you know, we drown Meredith, or Christina's covered in blood and it's Macbeth.
Okay, bringing that up, not to interrupt you again, but were you scared?
We do that all the time.
Were you scared to be, you were killing your main character. That's scary. No? Where were you at? I mean, were you going, wow, I
was at a place where it was time for my main character to die. I mean, I'm not Ellen Pompeo, who I love, but honestly, Meredith Grey, I'll be honest, until I wrote sort of the last scene of the last episode of that three episode arc, as far as I was concerned, Meredith Grey was going to die at the end. Like, it was a pretty 95% sure thing that Meredith Grey was going to die. And that goes to my being awfully naive to the idea that maybe the network wouldn't be so happy with that. But for me, I was writing the story that sort of needed to be written at the time, and Meredith has a little bit of a problem with being alive, and that made sense to me. It really made sense to me, and I had a journey for her to go on, and I just wrote it. I feel like a lot of the show is me just moving on instinct. This is what the character needs to do. I'm not going to worry about whether or not the audience is going to be upset about, you know, George and Izzy sleeping together, because, or telling me that, you know, Meredith needs to have triplets or something like that. Because the reality of it is I can't, you're never going to please everybody all the time. The only person you can sort of please is yourself. That's and right. I have to be excited about the story. The whole ferry boat crash thing was really, Derek said that he had a thing for ferry boats, and ferry boats crash. And Meredith's mother told her that you were nothing more than ordinary. And Meredith was in a place where she felt like she couldn't sort of live anymore or deal with any of it. And breathing was hard. And to me, like, it all made terrific sense.
So what changed?
What changed was as I was writing it, I felt like because Denny came back, because I was like to come up with ideas for Denny to come back. But Denny
came
back.
There's an obsession here, clearly.
Yeah, and there was a way for there to be hope for her, and it wasn't about, because I don't write outlines, and I hadn't really discussed it with anybody. It wasn't about doing something that anybody told me to do. It was a lot about figuring out how Meredith could get through this, because I desperately wanted her to survive. I just didn't see how it was going to happen when I entered into this, and we were already shooting. And I really sort of felt like there has to be a way out of this that feels hopeful for her. And I realized that if her mother died, Meredith could survive. And it was about that for me. And I felt like, okay, now she can heal, because I was at a place where I was like, season three was not fun. And I was at a place where, like, I don't know if she can heal.
So what you're really saying, I mean, to some extent, and I just love it because it's coming out. The truth of it's coming out. It may be unconscious, but on some level, you allowed what was organically going on with you to really infuse itself into the series. And I believe personally that that's why the series feels so alive.
What's interesting to me is the writers just got together and we're watching all 71 hours of the show, which I can't believe there's 71, but we're watching all 71 hours of the show going into season 5, sort of talking about, you know,
Little threads
and learning things that you've forgotten. Doing it together.
Oh, how cool.
That's cool.
And learning it together, and we're having these sort of episode viewing marathons, and it's actually kind of amazing to watch the early episodes and remember things and discover things that and feel good about sort of what happened and feel like, oh, that didn't work or that really did work and we're going here and we're going there. And we've been watching all these hours, and a lot of it is just moving on instinct. A lot of it is, I forgot what I was going to say, but a lot of it is just moving on instinct.
Well, I was saying that there was, I could totally see that it's intuitive on your part. I mean, I can see that there's, that you just allow yourself to feel what you would like to see.
Yes. Okay. That my point was that the thing about watching it all with the writers was it felt incredibly embarrassing, like sitting in the room with all the writers and watching it.
It's kind of naked for you.
Yeah, because a lot of my psyche is just laid right there out on the page. I've clearly told any man in America what I'm looking for in a guy. I've clearly stated like all of my personal issues. I've said every single thing that could have been said about season 3. If you watch the entire season, it's all there on the page and on the screen. And that was really interesting to discover, that I've been writing sort of the underbelly of everything without even really knowing it.
That touches me so much. But were you shocked to sort of see, oh my God, that's really what it was talking about, or, you know, in watching all those episodes?
Yeah. I mean, there were some moments when, you know, most of the writers who have been on staff since season 1 or season 2, and we've all grown incredibly close. Like, there were some moments when we're all watching together, and Bailey will say something, or somebody will say something, and the entire room would go, oh, like, because they can hear me saying it, and hear that, like, that was exactly what was going on in my mind at the time. And it's an incredibly interesting experience to watch something and feel that naked.
This is really touching to me, because I feel like this is what, the fact that you allowed yourself to go there is what makes the show so indelibly you and so personal.
But it sounds like, just like she was sort of
allowed that to happen. I mean, you didn't pretend.
I feel like I don't know how.
You
not
can't.
With those characters.
Exactly. Or maybe not at all. I don't know. I mean,
I was just going to say that I'm like sort of amazed just listening to you that you had this sort of same attitude with yourself, a bit of an innocence with yourself, where you just sort of let yourself do your thing in the same way you said, you know what, get out. This is my process. Like you just sort of trusted that you would get there. I mean, I don't know what your freakouts are, your internal journey or whatever, but you did this thing where you have a bunch of people who work for you, okay? Yeah. I'm just picturing this in my mind, and the anxious line producer pacing up and down going, hey, Shonda, do you know any idea what kind of sets we might be having next week?
Yeah.
And that whole thing, and doing things your own way when no one is expecting for that to be done, and just having this, you know what, guys, this is the way I do it. But still, that just takes
strength,
but also sort of like, I don't know how else to do it. This is my thing.
Yeah, for me, like, creatively, I can't, I don't want this to sound precious because I feel like it does, and I hate that. I cannot write any other way. I literally cannot write any other way. Like, if I was asked to do it a different way, it wouldn't happen. There would be nothing on the page, and there'd be nothing to shoot.
Right.
The only way I know how to write is to sit at the little picnic table that I have outside my office, put on headphones, and Well, it didn't used to be a picnic table, but they made it a picnic. That's a long story. Disney has rules. And basically write what I feel and really go that way. And the only way I know how to be in a writer's room, because that was really scary for me at the beginning, was going from writing by myself to being in a room full of people who are staring at you, expecting you to vocalize all the stuff that I keep inside my head. The only way I know how to do that is to sort of go on instinct and talk about how the characters feel and what that all means and how the emotional underbelly of whatever's happening with the patient means something else for our characters. And I would spend hours in the room with the writers going, but what do you mean Meredith, you know, smiles and walks away? Or what do you mean Christina doesn't cry when this patient dies? She's got to cry because that's what happens. And I was like, but that's not what Christina would do. Like, it's just about, for me, it's just about knowing your characters extraordinarily well and then seeing where they take you.
Do you rewrite all the other scripts, or, you know, how involved are you with that other? But even just taking a pass or one last set of notes, because it feels like you are the authority on those characters.
There's incredibly talented writers on our show, incredibly talented writers who do a lot of incredible work. And I feel like, you know, I would never take credit on somebody else's script or do anything like that.
Yeah, I'm not even saying but you know what I'm saying, quality control.
Every episode goes through my computer. I think every episode but one of Grey's Anatomy has gone through my computer. And I always, there's a rule, I always write all of Derek's speeches because for some reason Derek's voice is just natural to my head. Or Christina's dialogue is very specific. The way she speaks is very specific to something that happens in my head. And so I always have to rewrite her dialogue. But that happens sort of naturally. And we sort of, because we've all been together for so long, it's not a thing that it's happening. People will come to me and be like, here's my episode. Do something about Derek's speech. And that's sort of how we work. And it works really well for us.
Well, that's pretty ordinary for the executive producer. The executive producer is the quality control, you know, the head of quality control. And especially if it's something that
especially if she's a creator, not only the creator, but...
I feel really protective of my writers, though, and their work. I mean, it's interesting. Another aspect of having never done television before, it never occurred to me that you would take somebody's work and rewrite it. Like, I would sit very carefully and talk to them, and like, the first episode, they were like, well, why don't you just make it what you want it to be? And I was like, okay, I'm going to, but I just want you to know that I really appreciate what you've done. It feels like people work really hard, especially in our group. People work really hard to get it right. So I always feel like you want to honor that part of it, because there's nothing more soul-crushing than someone taking your work away from you and writing all over it for kind of no reason whatsoever. So to me, I rewrite the stuff that needs rewriting. I don't rewrite for the sake of just saying I did it.
You don't go in with a sweeping.
No, not unless there's, you know, something just doesn't work. Yeah.
But when you're working that intuitively, I mean, how do you work with the other writers when you're sending them off to do first drafts?
We spend a lot of time in the room talking about everything, And a lot of
you mean like your lives.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, that's the crazy part, because I was never a sharer, and you have to become a sharer to be in the room. But also just about, we talk about every scene and what we think every scene is. We talk, you know, they come to me and say, like, what would Christina do in this situation, or what would Meredith do in this situation, or what would Izzy do in this situation? We talk about that. I always challenge any storyline that I feel like is too easy for someone to go through. Like, if I already know the beginning, when they start pitching it, if I already know the end at the beginning, then I throw it out, because I feel like I already know the end. You can't do a story where I already know what the end's going to be. We do a lot of that. And we talk about everything obsessively, all the details of stuff, and we steal liberally from our own lives. And we use that. So when a writer goes off to write, they have a very clear idea of where we're going and what we're doing.
Right. And, you know, we're gonna break in just about 1 minute and take a 10-minute break, and then come back for questions.
Okay.
But I just want to mention that you have this style. I've sort of alluded to it already, and we both have. But to me, you keep talking about speeches, and you write wonderful speeches, and you have this tendency, I notice, to people suddenly will launch into a real speech. You know, it's really.
Yeah.
It's really a speech. It reminds me of James L. Brooks. Ooh. It reminds me of Cameron Crowe, of that speech when he comes in and, you know, at the end of Jerry Maguire.
Had me at hello.
You had me at hello moment, but the speech he gives, or the speech she gives when she tells him that she's not put together that way, you know, that she's not made that way. I mean, there's a certain I'll use the word, I don't want to say old-fashionedness, but it's a beautifully written soliloquy, eloquent soliloquy that draws others in. You know, that it's a power, almost. It's the power of...
Oh, thank you.
Do you know what I mean, though? Like, you will do that with, like, you had Meredith do that when she says, pick me. You know, she has this speech where she persuades, where she's, and, you know, not everybody can write that way or does write that way. And I'm wondering if there are people who are imitating, if there are people trying to imitate that, or if you just go, don't even try to imitate it, I'll just do it.
No, literally, sometimes people turn in scripts that say, like, Derek's speech here or Mary's speech here. and I get it, because in a weird way, like, they're fighting something that they will never succeed against, because right. I always be like, but Derek would always say this or this. It's in my head. But sometimes people get it. Sometimes people get it dead on.
And then it feels almost like, wow, that sound like me.
Yeah, I love that, though. I love it. It doesn't sound like me. It sounds like the characters. I love when the characters sound like the characters.
But it sounds like the way you write the characters. I mean, you write those characters a certain way. No?
Yes,
they sound
and no.
like her little yes. friends.
Exactly.
Her little imaginary friends.
Little imaginary friends.
Okay, we're going to take a break now. And when we come back in 10 minutes, we'll have...